You're listening to a Frequency Podcast Network production.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Welcome to Wednesday. My name is Brock.
I'm Dalby. Have you seen, I hate calling her this, but I still don't know her name. The Huck-tua girl?
It's like Haley something.
Haley something, yeah. I saw a news reporter, like, I don't know, everybody's writing articles about this gal now.
Dude, her 15 minutes of fame has gone way longer than it should.
She's stretching it out. She's doing it the right way, which is great. But she says now that she's famous, she's worried about being kidnapped. And I'm just like, is that a thing that people have to worry about when you're famous? Being kidnapped? Like, is anybody out there going to roll up with a windowless van and try and kidnap Huck-tua girl?
I mean, I understand the paranoia because all of a sudden you, I don't know, you went just from working whatever job you had to being in the limelight. So that could be a bit of a trip.
I think she was in like a spring factory or something like that.
I don't think I've ever worried about being kidnapped before.
I will say, and I don't think I'm kidnappable. Like, if you kidnap me, you're not getting anything in
You might need at least like three guys to get you in the van.
I wasn't talking from a physical perspective.
Sorry.
I meant I don't have any money.
That's my bad.
But I will say, like, you've never been in, like, a parking garage or something like that late at night? Like, maybe you were doing some shopping or at the gym or something?
Yeah.
You've never walked back to your car and been like, this could happen.
There's certain places I've lived where I've, like, been worried about getting robbed. That's for sure. I lived in Prince Albert, and it was, like, had the second or third highest crime rate. And so every time I was walking home from the bar, I was like, oh, this guy's going to fuck me up.
Right. Wait, keep your head up is on the welcome to Prince Albert sign.
Like, yeah.
It's expected. That sort of thing. You've never felt like maybe somebody could just roll up and drag you away?
I mean, they absolutely could. I don't think about it, which maybe I should think about it, but I don't know. I feel like I watched enough Steven Seagal movies growing up to
you think you could fight off? A van pulls up, three dudes in masks all roll up trying to throw you in the van. You think you fight them off?
We actually talked about this yesterday with the fight thing. Dude, we learned just take off your pants, man. Nobody's going to want to kidnap the crazy guy.
I don't know, man. I feel like if someone has set their sights out to kidnap you, taking your pants off is not the deterrent.
Mm.
They've already made you the target. Taking your pants off to get out of a fight is good if it's a stranger.
Yeah.
These people would know who you are if they're going
to
kidnap.
I think my automatic move, if someone like grabs me and is trying to like take me away, I'm going to try and get a finger in their ass. Like that's you got to like play puppet master on them and like it's like the Uno reverse card,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
like look at me. I am the captain now.
Who's in charge of this kidnapping now?
It might work, it might not. But I don't know. It's worth a try, right?
Hey, anybody listening to this podcast, if you were thinking about kidnapping me, apparently I'm too fat.
Mm.
And if you were thinking about kidnapping Brock, you better wear some thick britches.
The Brock and Dalby. Brock and Dalby Podcast.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
I saw a story I want to bring to your attention because I feel like you'll have feelings about this. You know, Jeff Bezos,
yes,
owner of Amazon. People are writing Amazon articles like crazy about everything from the deals to the factories and all that stuff because it's Prime Day.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah.
So I saw a story that talked about one of Jeff Bezos' sort of philosophies when it comes to managing his businesses. And that is that he will not
let them go to the bathroom.
That too, yeah. That's factual. He will not go into a work meeting that has that breaks what he calls the two pizza rule. And that is that no meeting should be bigger than the amount of people that he says can be fed by two pizzas.
So, like, three people?
According to him, that means no meeting or work group at Amazon should be more than eight people.
Eight people?
In Jeff Bezos' mind, in the mind of a billionaire.
Brother, I could crush a box of pizza to myself, to the dome, like right now.
It's just crazy to think that you and I could be a work meeting at Amazon.
So, a box of pizza is usually like eight slices?
Eight slices, and then depending on your small, medium, large,
two slices
size.
A person? That's wrong.
Yeah, honestly.
Two slices a person? I hate that.
I knew you would not appreciate this.
You can't just have two slices of pizza when you get a box of pizza.
It's like when you're at a work meeting or like your work is having a pizza party. party.
Yeah.
And they bring in like enough for everybody to have one slice. And you're like, what am I supposed to do with this?
Also, what is Jeff Bezos like worth? He could like splurge for a few more pizzas. Could he not?
Two pizzas, eight people. That's it. Every pizza feeds four people and then get back to work.
That actually makes me quite upset. Like, I'll order a pizza, sure. And I'll have, like, six slices, and actually Courtney will have two because I'll eat six, but that's nonetheless.
But that's the serving size. You guys have it figured out. That's the thing. You found your pizza equilibrium, but I just picture a meeting where it's Jeff Bezos and seven other people, and they're sitting there, and there's two pizzas on the table, and everybody has to go through that same feeling of, like, is somebody else in here not hungry? Can I eat my two slices? Do I dare go for a third? Am I greedy? Am I going to ruin the day?
Dude, the leftover slice that's sitting there and you know that everyone's just thinking about grabbing it.
Everyone's got full vulture mentality. They're all sitting there perched like, oh.
Well, and the lame thing is, and like no disrespect to every pizza place ever.
No.
But they do not know how to cut the slices equally. So you know some people are getting shafted on that baby slice there.
That's just it. Yeah. There's always one slice that's just not up to snuff. And then that means on the other side of the pizza, there's one king size slice. Does the person who gets that slice only get one and a half?
Well, that's the thing. He better be ordering like large pizzas. I want to see something real quick. Yeah. Look up like.
Could you imagine if Jeff Bezos, Amazon billionaire,
got two mediums? Two Little Caesar hot and readies?
Two medium pizzas feeds eight people and we pay them less than minimum wage.
Hold up.
Everything's fine.
I want to see something here. I'm just going to look up Domino's serving size.
That's a pizza company everybody
knows. I just want to see what the serving size for a large pizza.
Oh, you got real quiet all of a sudden.
Take a guess. Large pizza.
At Domino's.
What do you think the serving size is? How many people do you think that goes for?
I mean, I'll take the Jeff Bezos guess and I'll say it feeds four people.
They say 5 to 6.
5 to 6 people on one large pizza?
That doesn't even make sense. There's eight slices. Not even everyone. That sucks, dude. I don't want to live in a world where that's a thing.
Imagine ordering a large pizza. There's six of you. You order a large pizza and you have to democratically figure out which two people get a second slice.
Dude, what did the cheaper by the dozen family do, man?
They did not eat pizza, that's for sure.
That sucks.
It was bowls of gruel for everybody.
No, you got to have at least a minimum of three slices each, man.
I think that's fair. Three slices each. Although then you run into the problem of three doesn't go into eight.
Are we fat guying here right now? Like, I'm curious. You get a box of pizza. Right. How many slices are you expecting to crush?
Maybe it is us. I mean, I fat guy all the time.
Sure.
I am a fat guy.
Sure.
You're not. So, you know, are you just a glutton?
Yeah.
Are we wrong? Or is Domino's and Jeff Bezos wrong?
A two slice minimum? a two slice maximum?
Hey. I think you've had enough. Time to go home.
That actually, for some reason, makes me mad.
Getting cut off at the Pizza Hut buffet.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
When the moon hits your eye like a big...
We learned that a large pizza serving is supposed to serve 5 to 6 people, and that just ain't right.
But you know what the nice thing is that the friends of the show agree with us.
The consensus here, I'm going to say, it's a minimum of 4.5 slices based on all the texts we're getting.
Per person.
Because some people are out of 6,
yeah.
Some people are out of 5.
Yeah.
Those are my people right there.
Well, and you know what, though? I will say, because there are some people that are saying, like, I'm a 2-slice person. And we need those people in our lives to make us feel better.
Yeah, I mean, you're the ones that we want to share the box with.
That's just it.
Yes. That's true.
For every 6-slicer, they can find a 2-slicer. It's like you and Courtney. You're the perfect couple.
Yeah, might disagree on that.
You're a 6 and a 2.
The amount of times that she goes to the box, she's like, dude, come on. Like, don't you love me, though?
But I did get curious because you said Domino's says...
Yeah.
That a large pizza should feed 5 to 6 people. And I thought, what else is hiding on box information.
Are we going to do serving sizes
about
here?
Serving sizes. So I found a few by looking at the nutritional information on different food items.
Yeah.
And I'm going to let you guess how many people that item should feed, and then I'll tell you whether you're right or wrong.
Oh, I feel like we're gonna get upset.
Oh, you're going to get super mad at this. That's the whole point.
Okay, lay it on me.
I thought we'd start with pizza pops. How many, a box of four pizza pops, the standard square box, how many people do you think that's supposed to feed?
Four?
It's four pizza pops, individually wrapped, two and two.
I mean, it should be two people.
Yeah.
But I'm going to guess they're going to say four.
That's correct. It's one pop per person.
That's wrong.
That's one pizza pop. That means when you open the box and you take the package out and you pop it open and you have two pops, you have to find someone else to share it with.
No.
Or else you're greedy.
No. They know their demographic. It's stoners.
Like, yeah. No, four per person.
That's stupid.
On the same idea, how about Pop-Tarts? You get a box of four Pop-Tarts and then they're individually packaged again, two and two. Or sorry, no, you get, I think you get like four packages of two.
You get two in the wrapper, yeah.
Two in the wrapper, let's just say that. For one wrapped pair of Pop-Tarts, how many servings is that?
That should be one.
Nope, it's one tart per person.
What?
You get one Pop-Tart per person. Again, you're meant to open it up and share with a friend.
No, the commercial even would have the kid eating two.
Yeah, no, that kid's a pig.
Okay.
Kraft dinner, a box, standard box of Kraft dinner. You know the one.
That's like one to two people.
Four servings.
No, it's that can't feed.
It is meant to feed. One box of Kraft dinner is meant to feed four people.
Dude, you gotta have a skinny ass family.
Dude, for me and the kids, I make two boxes.
Yeah.
Never mind four people.
I'll crush a box to myself.
How about instant ramen? Just a package of Mr. Noodles. I mean, there's a million different brands.
Okay, so I know my answer is obviously wrong, but it should be one.
Half a brick per person. It's meant to feed two people. When you boil ramen, add in the little flavor, whether you leave it in the broth or you just serve it as noodles, it is meant to feed two people.
No, it can't.
Absolutely, that's what
it's not for. Physically possible.
69 cents feeds two people, brother.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. We're not in wartime right now.
We're not rationing our noodles.
Yeah, what the hell? That's when they must have done this. Like,
how about microwave popcorn? Just, you know, the simple Orville Redenbacher bag of popcorn. Put it in the microwave, fill it up. Not the mini bags. The full bag of popcorn.
Please tell me it's not more than two people.
It is 2.5.
Two and a half.
Two and a half servings in every bag of microwave popcorn. You're allegedly supposed to get one cup of popcorn per person per bag.
Nobody does this stuff.
You take one cup. Whoop, that's your popcorn. You don't eat a kernel more than that.
Dude, imagine hanging out with someone who did that. Not friends.
Losing the draw and being the half a person. You only get half a cup of popcorn. And I'll finish with one more that it just makes me laugh because it's so specific.
Oh, this is pissing me off.
Ruffles, all dressed chips, the blue bag in the grocery store, the big bag, like the family bag,
yeah.
200 gram bag of chips. How many people is that supposed to feed in a single session? How many servings do you think is in a big bag, 200 grams, Ruffles, all dressed chips?
Well, just based off of everything else, I don't know, what, 17 people? Like,
No. For once, you're on the high side.
Is it four?
It is four people. And it is meant to, out of a 200 gram bag.
That's not even the family size, though.
It's a 200 gram bag, 50 grams per serving, or 23 chips. It says on the bag, 23 chips is a single serving of all dressed chips.
I don't think anyone in their right mind has ever counted. Dude, I swear, like, a handful of chips is like half that.
Could you imagine walking into somebody's house and they're like, hey, you want some snacks? Maybe you're there for a poker game. You want some chips? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
You know who does that? I think we all had that friend growing up who had that mom that, like, you didn't want to eat at their house.
Yeah.
That's a nightmare sleepover as a kid.
Everything was bland, flavorless, and, like, doled out in very strict rations.
Dude, I feel like the people that make this are just trying to make you feel bad.
Man, I went to Timmy's house for a sleepover yesterday. His mom gave me 22 chips.
Serving sizes is just fat shaming is all it is. It's not real.
Well, the idea is that you won't won't get fat if you only eat 23 chips.
It's just being mean, man.
They also don't say how many servings you can have at once. So, you know, there's that.
True.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Anytime you got something to say, leave us a message. 1-833-854-2233. We got someone who's got some relationship problems, I guess you could call it here.
All right. Serious question for you guys. How do you feel about double dipping? I got into, wouldn't call it an argument, but maybe an ongoing debate that I've had with my girlfriend for the past few years. I guess some backstory. We were having nachos the other night. No, I dip my nachos in the salsa, one would. Take a bite, take another dip. And for some reason, she doesn't like that, which makes no sense to me. I mean, we've been dating for like 3 years. It's not like we're strangers or something. But don't get me wrong, double dipping with a stranger, like, that's a no-go. But I feel like I'm not in the wrong here, boys. Help me out. Let me know what you think. Cheers. Love the show. Take care, guys.
Now, no one can see your head. You're shaking your head. I don't have a problem with what he did, but you do. No?
Girlfriend, boyfriend, relationship, significant other. I think that is the absolute line of double dip or no double dip. First of all, if you're not sharing spit in any other way, you better not be double dipping.
I think
that's disgusting.
I think people get too worked up on double dipping and not worried about people washing their hands. Like, if you're sharing stuff with people, I think you need to be more worried about that. But
in a perfect world, yes, it's wash your hands.
As a couple, you're allowed to in a relationship. What's mine is yours. What's yours is mine. I'm also going to assume if you've been, did you say 3 years?
Yeah,
2 years, something
like that.
If you've been dating that long, I'm going to assume your tongues have been in worse places.
Yeah, so to speak, yes.
Right?
Yes, yeah, yeah.
And you're worried about dip, of all things?
I mean, it's just, I think another part of it is, like, how does the person eat? Like, if you're taking the chip and you're dipping, you're taking, like, a very fine bite or whatever, and then you're dipping again. If you're in a relationship, okay, fine. Well, I'm not pumped about it, but fine.
Well, here's the circumstances. Like, if we're out for dinner, like, what am I supposed to get, an extra dip for her? Is that what I'm supposed to do?
First of all, knowing you, you would.
No.
So let's, you know, just to have more dip on the table.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't know. I think that's why I don't really like the idea of sharing an order of nachos. Because I feel like we're all diving into the same thing with our bare hands. We're sharing dips. And then you have to worry about other people's sanitary issues. Whereas if this is my pile of nachos and these are my dips and you get your own, then we're just happier people.
But that's what I'm saying. If you're in a relationship, it's supposed to be shared, all right? Especially if you're married, you're supposed to support each other. You're supposed to be as gross as possible.
Hey.
You should be comfortable sharing your food, sharing your drink, ripping ass in front of each other. You should be able to poop in front of each other.
Listen, one of us here has been married before. And I said, in sickness and in health, for richer or poorer and all those other things, at no point did the justice of the peace who married me and my wife ever ask us if we would share a dip.
I would include that in sickness and health, actually.
Well, why? Because we're going to get sick because we're sharing the dip?
Love is about sharing, all right? You're supposed to share your love. You're supposed to share your damn dip.
I will share my life. I will share my experiences. I will share my very soul. But why don't you get your own salsa?
If you can't double dip, you're not meant to be. That's...
That's the line.
I don't mean to be rude, dude. But you can't double dip. You weren't meant to be together.
Listen, two blankets in the bedroom, two dips with the nachos. Secret to a happy life.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Talking about double dipping this morning.
I don't think that's the dip that song's about.
That's not what that's about?
I don't think it's like a nacho cheese song.
It's not about dipping nachos? That blew my mind.
Also, I hate the idea that it's like, when I dip, you dip, we dip. Now we're all having synchronized dipping? Get out of here.
Well, this all started because we had a bad line message from a young man who's saying that he's being scolded for double dipping in the nachos. I don't think there's a problem there, honestly.
I'm not a double dip guy, but apparently... I'm in the minority.
Yeah, we've got a lot of texts coming in. There's one that came in here. It said, I'm with Dolby on the double blankets in the room, not the dip. I would eat the dip out of my wife's mouth if she would let me.
I don't think that's right to ask your wife to be your dip bowl. Like, what do you, it's like she dips, takes too much of the salsa, and you're like, let me get a little bit of that. Open up. Yeah. Let me dip in there.
A few people are like Robert on the text line. They say, I have no issues with double dipping, but there is an issue with the person who takes too much of the dip.
Absolutely. That's another reason that I hate sharing nachos, is because inevitably it starts out amicable. We get the big plate of nachos between us. There are many great options, and everybody starts out polite. Oh, one dip, eat, one dip, eat. Then it's going to become competitive, because now it's like a game of it's like a game of battleships. We're trying to find territory.
Well, I think we all do it when we eat food, and especially with nachos. I mean, if you've ever seen the sketch comedy show I Think You Should Leave, there's a sketch about it of like where the guy's on a date and he's like, she's taking all the nachos with all the toppings.
That's right. Inevitably, at every restaurant you go to and order nachos, there's going to be a perimeter wasteland that nobody wants to eat. They're dry, they're stale, they're burned, there's no cheese, there's no toppings. Even the dip can't save these chips. And the last thing you want is to be edged out on the good territory by the person you're sharing with.
Well, we talked about pizza a bit this morning, but even, like, think about it. When you're collectively eating pizza with a group of people, everyone in their mind is already eyeing out their slice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's like, I'm going to take that one. And if you see the guy who goes out of his way to separate two slices to grab the big one.
Right.
That's gross.
That's gross. Get your hands off all the pizza and stop trying to hoard it.
I'm not even mad that you're touching the slices.
You're being rude.
You're a piece of garbage.
It's like trying to find a nice
you're a
way
piece
to put
of
it.
Garbage. If you do that while you're eating, I think we can all agree. If you're the person who goes out of their way and yeah. is selfish, you don't care.
It's a weird self-preservation thing. Like, everybody thinks it, but you have to have a certain screw loose to be the person who's like, I'm going to do this.
And I will say, you know, if we're sharing dips, you can't be the person who goes in for a big scoop. You gotta have courtesy scoops, all right?
Right. You have to actually dip. You put down and up, and that's it. If we're sharing a sour cream or a salsa, mm-hmm. and you go swooping in like one of those water bomber planes scooping a lake, we have a problem here.
Sharing dip is like making love. There's gotta be... You know, like, there's got to be two working together. Like, one person can't be focused on themselves other than the other. Yeah. Otherwise, things aren't going to go well. You don't want the dip to go too fast, right? You want the dip to be around, to be enjoyable for everyone. I think that's the thing that we need to keep in mind here.
That's our next t-shirt. Using dip, sharing dip is like making love.
This is the Brock and Dalby Podcast.
The robot uprising is getting closer and closer every single day.
What did AI do to you now?
It's not AI.
Oh.
It's legit robots.
Oh.
Major League Baseball has announced that next year at spring training,
yeah,
they're going to start testing out robot umpires.
Finally. Thank God. Yes. I'm on board. I am fully supportive of this idea.
Are you actually?
I am 100%.
Why?
We just watched the retirement of the worst umpire in the history of baseball.
Angel Hernandez?
Absolutely. Every time I turn on SportsCenter, every time I watch a John Boy breakdown on YouTube, it's all about how bad the umpires are.
All right. I get that.
Let's get some robots in there.
As a baseball fan, I'm going to say you're taking out the human element of the game, one, and two, who the manager is going to yell at. You're never going to see one of those things. You're never going to see a manager come out of the dugout and get pissed off anymore.
That, okay.
What's he going to do, punch a computer screen?
To your first point about how it, like, takes out the human element, the umpires now take out the human element because it's supposed to be pitcher versus batter, not pitcher versus batter versus umpire who could be on either side, who
sure.
knows. Your second point is actually very good.
I'll say this. I use Google Maps. That thing can't even figure out where I'm going sometimes. You're just going to basically be putting self-checkouts out there.
Like, yeah, yeah, honestly.
And then what if they break down in the middle of a game?
That'll be interesting. Instead of having to have an umpiring crew, will they have to have like a crew of IT technicians who run onto the field and start fixing cameras?
Yeah.
Strike zone sensors, that
sort
of thing.
What if it gets fouled into, right?
Right. Well, I mean, to be fair, umpires get fouled into sometimes and they also break down. So that actually is the most human-like thing that could happen.
Valid. Valid. I just feel like the biggest thing that I'm going to miss, because they're saying if it does well in spring training next year,
right,
in 2026,
we could go to a full-time situation.
Which makes me mad, because it's like the self-checkout thing. Mm-hmm. People are losing jobs. Don't like that at all.
Well, they're not very good at it, though.
And also, how much are you going to miss the...
But I think we can program that in, right? We've already got a guy at every
major... Oh, I don't like that.
We've already got a guy at every Major League Baseball game who's playing the organ and sound effects and all those things. Just give him a soundboard of various... and let him push the button every time the robot says it's a strike.
It's not the same, man.
It's not the same, but at the same time, the sanctity of the game is...
Who are you working for?
What?
Why are you so for the robots here, man?
Brother, our parent corporation is heavily involved in Major League Baseball. What do you mean, who am I working for?
Oh, God. I can't handle it, man. Also, it's just like, to have it up to that, and if... I don't know. I feel like it's not going to be a good idea. Like,
well, I mean, that's the thing, right? That's why they're testing it. They tested it in the minor leagues. It did well there.
Sure.
They're going to test it at spring training to see if it can handle the game at a major league speed. And if it can get through another round of testing and prove to be better than the current sham that we have now, where every game is decided by what side of the bed an umpire woke up on... I know you hate the robots. I know you think that they're going to take over the planet.
It's a bad idea.
I will miss manager temper tantrums. Maybe we can put like a little, you know, those boxes you see on the side of some highways that have a traffic camera in it?
Sure, yeah.
Maybe we can put like a little umpire shirt and hat on one of those, and refs can come kick dirt at the screen or something. But for the overall game, I think I'm on board for robot umpires.
I can't do the robot umpires. No human element. No manager's getting mad. No, yes!
No, because instead it'll be like,
yeah. The only good thing will be is having an excuse that the robots are against the Jays.
God, they programmed the robots to call those balls.
That would be the only good thing.
The fix is in.
The Brock and Dalby.
Brock and Dalby
podcast.
The Brock and Dalby podcast.
Are you ready to hear the greatest headline you're going to hear all week?
Brother, you know I love a good headline.
You ready?
Yes.
Fight breaks out between two women in gynecology waiting room. And there is a police report with it.
Hell yeah, let's get some details.
Check this out. On July 2nd, police responded to a fight between two women at the advanced gynecology office. Apparently, a 33-year-old woman reported that she was in the waiting room with her three children when a 51-year-old woman sitting nearby began tapping her fingers loudly on a chair.
Just drumming her fingers on an empty chair.
Apparently, the first lady says this upset one of her children. The first lady became annoyed and said to her, "Someone is going to cuss you out." That's when the second lady responded by challenging the woman to step outside.
Okay, hang on. Pause. Time out. So, kid gets mad at sound. Mom immediately goes to, "You're going to get cussed out." Woman number two immediately escalates to, "Let's throw hands."
She's like, "What makes you the authority around here?"
That's crazy.
Let's go outside kind of thing.
There are so many steps they both skipped. Carry on.
So, she accepted.
Kids, you stay here. Mom is going to go handle some business.
As they were entering the exit door, the tapping woman turned, punched the other woman in the face.
Oh, she suckered her in front of her kids.
Then grabbed her by the throat and skirt, causing the woman to push her back into the waiting room.
Damn.
The facility employees separated the woman until the cops could arrive. The tapping woman has now been taken to jail and is on a battery charge and has been banned from the business.
You're going to have to find a new gynecologist, lady.
That is a wild story.
I guess, because if they had both gone outside and squared up, then it's a fight, and there's not one person who's in the wrong. You're both in the wrong, but by turning around and sucker punching her back into the waiting room.
I will say, I am surprised that stuff like this doesn't happen more often.
Mm.
Waiting rooms are a real test of your patience.
Especially, I'll say this, especially if you have kids in tow.
Yes.
And especially if the appointment's not for them, because you can't even tell them, like, The doctor needs to look at that. Just sit still. Well, they have no skin in the game.
The tapping thing is legit. Like, people do their nervous tics, whatever. Sure, they're tapping, yeah. They're breathing. I mean, hell, I know I always reference Service Ontario for the worst place to be. But you see people lose it on each other. Not even just the staff there. You see people lose it on people all the time. I am surprised you don't see fights happen more often.
Right, yeah. Service Ontario, I feel like we've all at least seen some sort of verbal altercation at a Service Ontario at one point or another in our lives.
Yeah.
But you're right. I've never seen anybody actually, like, dust up in there. Maybe because they're all so small. But you're right. Waiting rooms do feel like they are a petri dish for fisticuffs.
The thing that drives me crazy in waiting rooms, people who have the texting sound on their phone, there's no reason for that.
Who is that for? The only reason you would need a sound is to let you know that you're actually texting. You're looking at your phone. Text sounds only exist so you can text and drive, and I will die on that hill.
I will say this. If you've been in a waiting room recently and you haven't fought someone...
Don't be very careful with
No, no. A round of applause.
Okay. I thought you were going to encourage it.
It's a real test of your patience.
Yeah.
And it's a real testament to who we are as people.
If you have not thrown hands in a waiting room, there is some good in you.
If you can survive a waiting room, you can survive anything.
I'm sorry for making assumptions about you.
It's okay. You want to go outside, though?
Hang on. Let me get my kids.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast.
Ed's word of the day.
Good morning. Today's word, humdinger. Yeah, humdinger. H-U-M-D-I-N-G-E-R, humdinger. And it's a person, thing, event, action, or statement having strong, extraordinary, or excellent effect. Well, I tell you, I love a humdinger of a good time. So, anyways, that's about it. Have a great one. Cheers.
I feel like that's like an old, like, 40s, 50s kind of, like...
Oh, absolutely. Thing. Yeah, like, yeah.
Ah, gee willikers, sure had a humdinger of a time.
Nothing like seeing a roux, but a humdinger, you know?
Yeah.
I love it, though. I feel like humdinger is one of those words that, like, it didn't have to go away.
Make humdinger great again?
It's still easy to say. You went out with a bunch of the fellas. Maybe you had some drinks last night. Whoa, what a humdinger that was.
Yeah.
Well, coming up this weekend, I'm sure lots of people got some humdinger plans for this weekend. There's a lot going on.
I'll tell you, Friday is going to be a humdinger.
Friday's
going to
be a humdinger and a half. A humdinger.
Kids, if maybe your parents are divorced and your dad's got a new girlfriend and you want to make your mom jealous, go home and be like, Dad's new girlfriend is more of a humdinger than you are. It's a great way to use it.
It's a great way to get yourself in trouble. Or to get yourself a brand new Xbox. Yeah. One or the other.
I mean, yeah, you want to butter up your girl, be like, you're a real humdinger, babe.
Weekends with mom are a humdinger.
Yeah. I hate you, mom. You're not a humdinger.
You don't humding anymore. You used to humding with the best of them.
I don't like that.
No?
I don't like that.
Did I push this one too far?
You gotta have the ER at the end.
You can't just humding?
No, you can't humding.
So it has to be an adjective. It can't be a verb. I can't be like, I'm humdinging this weekend.
The more you say it, the worse it gets.
I thought you were a humdinger. Here we are.
Humdinger. Use it wherever you can, all right?
For more Brock and Dalby, tune in weekday mornings 5:30 to 9.
The Brock and Dalby Podcast is brought to you by BadShop.ca, the Brock and Dalby merch store, with all proceeds going to the Canadian Cancer Society.